Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate how to create an effect something like this. But the general idea of the principle I'm going to demonstrate here is how to create a load of particles that then follow the outline of a mesh form. So in this case, I used a human mesh, a human model, and then had the particles sort of crawl up the mesh. And I think overall it was quite effective. I've also got a pulsating light in here, and I'm going to do this in Eevee. So to begin with, let's just create our particle. So I'm just going to use a simple cube to start with. Now, there's no particular reason for doing that, except that you can create a sphere that has quads instead of odd shapes. And therefore, if you wanted to put something more interesting in terms of a texture or a material on these bubbles, then, or eggs as somebody called them, then that will make it easier to do so, especially if you want to distort or move that material. So we'll go into edit mode, we'll right click and say subdivide, and we'll put not too many, but we'll put a few subdivisions on there. I like to have it such that there is an odd number of sides, not an even number. So you can see there, we'll have a point in the middle. I prefer to have it so that we've got a square face in the middle, and that's plenty. So while it's still in edit mode, press F3 and start typing to sphere, and then you'll find you can move the mouse and you can see it turns it into a sphere. And we'll right click and say shade smooth. If you need to, of course, you can add a subdivision surface, but bear in mind we're going to have a lot of these. But the key thing is you can see it's all quads, so that's polygons with four vertices at the corners, which makes it a lot easier to unwrap if that's what you want to do. So we're not going to do too complex a material for this, but obviously you can do whatever you want to do. So we'll bring the shader editor up here. We'll go to the material section and just add a new material. And for this one, I don't need the principled shader. So I'm going to add an emission shader to start with. And for my purposes, I set it to blue and I had a strength of about 4. Take that straight into there. And there is our faintly glowing ball. Although objects can emit light in Eevee, you won't, if you had a plane in here, for example, that light wouldn't be shining on that plane. You can't illuminate objects with other objects in Eevee, but the objects themselves can emit light. But I wanted to make that a bit more interesting than that. So we'll now add another shader node, and this one's going to be an add shader. And now I'll add a subsurface scattering shader, put that into the other side. I set mine to a sort of green color, quite a dark green color. At this point, you won't really see any difference until we add some more nodes. So I'm now going to add a mix shader, and I'll put the emission shader into the bottom, and then I'm going to add a glass shader. I used an index of refraction of about 1.73, but you just need to play around with the values until you get something you like the look of, and a roughness of 0.1. Make sure the color is all white, and then take that into the other side of the mix shader. If we go all the way one way, obviously we can see nothing because the background is black, and then all the way to the other and we can see our emission. And then I'm going to add an input, which is a layer weight. Take the facing output and put that into there. So this really looks at how straight on or otherwise to the camera a particular part of the geometry is. And so you can see we've got a dark spot in the middle there. And if I play with this blend number, you can see how that changes. So I had mine set to 0.05, and you can see that gives us a darker shade there. At this point, what I'm also going to do now is add some lights into the scene. So I'm going to add a light, which is an area light. So let's just turn that to face the object. So we'll scale that up and put this somewhere like here, and perhaps tilt it down a little bit. I had mine set to about 200 watts and about 0.25 for the size. And now you can see that subsurface scattering is having a slight effect. It's giving that green color in the middle. We'll just name that what was a cube particle, and we'll give it another light, and we'll put this one over here, I think, perhaps more like here. Make that one even bigger, and this is effectively our key light. Make that one slightly bigger, in fact. So this is the main illumination. We'll set this one to 500, and we'll leave the size at 0.25, and then I'll put a lamp behind, and I'll set it up above and then tilt it down. I'm not actually going to leave this particle here, but this is roughly where I'm going to have the action. So this is one of the back lights that I'm going to have, and this one only 140 watts, and then another one which we'll put over here somewhere. Make that one a little bigger, and we'll give this one a sort of greenish color just to pull out the green color in there. And now if we go to rendered view, you can see we're getting some interesting effects. And because this is a glass shader, it's actually reflecting our brightest lamp in there, and you can see the slightly dimmer lamp behind it. So that's just going to give us a little bit of something to make that a bit more of an interesting object. So let's put our particle off to one side now. And now we're going to import a mesh. Now you could create your mesh, of course, or just do what I'm doing, which is importing it. So mine is an OBJ file. There's lots of different applications you can use to get either meshes that are posed how you want them, or you can just download meshes or create them yourself, of course. So you can see our figure is here. He's a little bit on the small side, so we'll scale him up, perhaps to somewhere about there. And I'm also going to come up here now, click this little icon, and I'm going to click this little camera symbol, which allows me to quickly set things to be visible or not visible, and also to render them or not render them. So I don't want him actually rendered, so I've just turned that off, but he's still visible. And this one's called Struggle Man. The reason I wanted to add him at this point is because I want to be able to see where his feet and knees and things like that are. So I'm now going to add a mesh circle. I'm going to scale that down a bit. And then I'm going to put that circle roughly under a foot. Go into edit mode and just press F to fill it. And then in edit mode, I'm just going to duplicate it and put one under his other foot. It doesn't matter if his foot's poking through it slightly. I'm just going to leave it at that. When I did this the first time, I actually put these little discs, some of them under his knees, some at his hips, and I think one just in front of his chest. But you'll see what this is all about in a moment. And we'll call that particle emit. And then we'll come over to here and we'll add a particle system. It's going to be a simple emitter system. We're going to have quite a lot of particles eventually, but we'll leave it at 1,000 for the moment. Frame start is usually going to be frame one, so you want the particles to start emitting straight away, and the frame end is going to be about the end of your animation. So I've only got 250 frames here, so I'll set that to 250. You want the lifetime to be either as long as your animation or at least a significant proportion of it, so I'm going to set that to 250 as well. Otherwise the particles will start disappearing before they've got all the way up the character, and we're probably going to need to extend this anyway. If I just press play now, you can see we've got some particles being emitted and they're dropping down. It's obviously not what we're looking for, so we'll immediately come down to field weights. This is the effect of all the different types of force, including gravity. And I'm going to set gravity to -0.2. If I press play now, you can see particles are emitted and just float upwards, but not too quickly. Next thing I'm going to do is say how I want the particles emitted. So we'll go to source. I pretty much left this under default. For velocity, I actually put this up slightly because some of the later discs that I added, I actually put a slight angle on them to sort of fire them towards the body slightly. But I don't think it makes that much of a difference. Rotation is important if you have got something other than a sphere. But for a sphere, or at least a sphere that is homogeneous in material, if it's got a material that is not the same one side to another, or you have a shape which isn't a sphere, then you may want to use rotation, which will allow you to add either a continuous rotation to it, a dynamic rotation, or at least to control how it is rotated. But for our purposes in this demonstration, it doesn't matter. So it's currently saying render as halo. We want to render as object. And of course, it could be a group of objects, but we're just going to use one. And we're going to select our particle object. So if I press play now, you can see our object is coming up. If I go to our particle object and give that a color in the viewport, you can now see what's going on there. And for the moment, that's pretty much all we need to do for the particles. So now we'll go to our mesh figure. And what we need to do is come into here under physics and say force field. We use the default of a force. And these settings will vary a bit depending on the scale. And of course, unless you measure it, you can never be quite sure whether you've got exactly the same scale. So we'll just put in the settings I used to begin with, and then we may need to tweak them. So strength, I used -8. And what that is means attract rather than repel. Flow, I put 5. So that sort of makes the particles flow together rather than just randomly move. Rotation doesn't really matter, so I'll take that off. Otherwise, it's trying to calculate things that are irrelevant. I put noise at 10 to obviously add some variation. I then also set a max distance, which we'll need to tweak in a moment. And the value I used was 2.75 meters. So this basically means that the force isn't infinite. It has a point at which it no longer affects particles. And then under here where it says shape, set this to surface. We go back to the beginning, you can now see suddenly it's all slowed down and the particles are crawling up the body. So we just let those run for a moment. The values I've put in there seem to be working quite well at the moment. We'll see what it does when it gets to the top of the figure, if it can do that in the 250 frames we're using for this demonstration. And you can see they get to the top there. If I turn this outline off, you can see it better. And then they're sort of gathering at the top of his head. And I wanted them to actually peel off the top of the figure, so I did something else as well. But you can see that's quite interesting. And if we go to rendered view, at the moment, he's got no material on him, which is why he's coming out that funny color. But if we turn him off in the viewport as well, you can see we've got these objects coming up like that. So in order to get the particles to sort of peel away from him, I also then added some additional force fields. So just add force field, which is just a force, and I put it up here. I ended up putting several because I wanted to peel particles off his hands better as well. But to begin with, we'll just do that. And I'm just arranging it so that that little spherical outer border is just touching the particles that are gathering at his head. And then again, I'll set this to the settings I used, and then we'll see if we need to adjust those. So strength I set to -9. Again, we don't need to worry about rotation. And max distance, ticked that. I set it to 8. We'll put that there now. We'll see what that does. So you can see that's much too big. We've got this dotted line now out here. So I can shrink that down. I really just want it to be somewhere around his face. So that's where this new force will start to affect particles. It will be at maximum on this inner ring. So let's push the particles back and start them going again. You still get one of these rings for the force that's around the figure, but it's not really that relevant. It just gives you a general idea of how wide it is. So you can see any particles that are quite a distance from the figure will still be drawn into the figure, which may or may not be what you want. So you can see we're getting some particles coming up, and they're starting to look a little more reluctant to stay on the figure. And then when they get to his head, they're starting to rise up, and they'll go up there, and then they'll stick there. And you can see these ones getting to his hands. If there'd been more time, they'd have started to peel away as well. And what you can also do is you can then go to your particle emitters under particles, and you can go to the cache and just say bake. It'll bake fairly quickly, depending on how many particles you've got in the scene. And then it will be nice and easy to go back in, change materials and do whatever, and you won't need to worry about having to recalculate things. And we're nearly there now. All I'm going to just say is that for the particle system, once that's baked, you probably will want to turn off show emitter. So if I turn that off there and we go into rendered view and I turn this off and turn off the visibility of my figure, because we're in preview mode, they actually still show up, but when you go to the rendered view, they don't. I'll do a quick render once we've got some particles coming up. So we're getting them coming up there. We're just coming up towards the end. And of course, because we have baked this, we can actually scrub backwards and forwards very quickly now. We don't have to wait for it to calculate. So just a little bit about some of the Eevee settings now that I used. So as most people do, I used bloom. I set threshold to about 0.7, so that makes it slightly more bloomy. I set radius slightly higher at 7.5. I turned on screen space reflection, and you may see a slight brightening when I do that. And that's because they're now reflecting each other. I turned on refraction because I am using a refractive shader, so it was worth doing that, I felt. I turned thickness down to 0.1. I'm not sure it made much of a difference. And I put soft shadows on. What you can then do is come down under color management and have a bit of a play in there. By default, it'll come as filmic, most likely. But I then set that to medium high contrast and just play around with the exposure to get the effect you're looking for. So we'll just set the camera to be able to see an interesting part of the scene. Obviously, I've got slightly larger particles here than I used previously, and not as many. I ended up adding 75,000 particles, which is obviously a lot, and that really will outline the figure. I'll do a few more in a moment and we'll see. So let's just do a quick render, and then we'll go to the compositor and say use nodes. So first of all, I added under color a brightness and contrast node and just set the contrast up slightly. So I set that at 0.3. Then I added under color a hue saturation node and set the saturation just up very slightly to 0.01. Added in under color a mix node, drop that in there, set it to multiply, then added under matte an ellipse mask, set the width to 1, and I had the height set to 0.45, and that goes into the other side of our multiply, and I set the multiply mix value to 0.95. just to back it off a bit. This is just adding a vignette. And then just to soften the vignette, I added filter, which is a blur node, into there. Set that to fast Gaussian. Relative, because we want to identify that it's a wide scene. And I set the blur amount to 10%. So you can see it just darkens the edges of the scene and helps focus the attention in the middle. So if we go back, we'll go back to the beginning. I won't do quite as many, but we have a look. We don't actually have to see our figure for these particles to climb up it. If we go to our particle system now, let's make the particles a little smaller, delete the bake, and let's just go down slightly. So for this particular figure, I'm now using 0.03. You can also add a slight randomness to it, of course. So I added about 0.3 randomness. That just gives you slight variation in the size of the particles. And now I used 75,000. I won't do quite that many here. I've only got a couple of emitters, but let's go for 20 1000 particles now. Go back to the beginning and press play. This is just baking as it's going. And you can see we've got these particles creeping up figure. And because there's so many of them now, we're able to see the outline of the figure much better. Again, I've only got 250 frames for the particles to climb up the figure here, but they seem to be getting on quite well. And again, I'd probably do even slightly smaller particles again, and certainly at least double the number of particles that I've got here. If I stop it for a moment, you'll see the details slightly better. And then if we render that, and there we go. So that's all there is to it. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.